So, der nächste Talk geht um ein ganz anderes Thema. Für mich war, wo ich das erste Mal davon gehört habe, da habe ich mich erstmal gewundert, weil es eigentlich total klar ist, dass man das so nicht macht, wenn man mit öffentlichem Geld Software programmieren lässt und dann am besten auch noch in verschiedenen Institutionen die gleiche Software programmieren lässt und die einfach nie veröffentlicht und quasi mit Steuergeldern eben Software kauft und sie eben den Source Code nie veröffentlicht, sondern sie quasi verheimlicht. Das habe ich noch nie so richtig verstanden, warum man das macht. Vielleicht verstehe ich es noch, ja, aber wahrscheinlich auch nicht, weil es niemand verstehen kann. Katharina Nokun und Basanta Thapa werden uns erzählen, was es mit der Kampagne Public Money, Public Code von der Free Software Foundation auf sich hat.
Yeah, thanks a lot. The next talk will be in English because this campaign is a European campaign, so we hopefully reach out to many other people outside this room. Hello stream, hello video. And yeah, the Public Money, Public Code campaign is a campaign initiated by the Free Software Foundation Europe. It was launched in September 2017. Back then, we built a large coalition of 31 NGOs. And we published an open letter in which we criticize the status quo of how public administrations deal with this whole licensing issue. When we look at software which is specifically funded by public institutions and for public institutions. So we have this crazy situation that there spent millions of euros for new software projects, cool software projects, but it's not licensed under a free software license. So we published this open letter, and in this open letter we also make a demand, which is, quote, "Dear politicians, please implement legislation requiring that publicly financed software developed for the public sector must be made publicly available under a free and open source software license." So this campaign really targets at making free software the default setting in public administrations. And we believe that having a legal framework can help to reach this goal. And when we were thinking about launching this campaign, we talked to a lot of people, and most of them said, yes, this is a huge problem, but are you sure you want to do this campaign? Because right now we don't have a large public debate about this issue. Yeah, most people in our community agree that this is a problem. Even a lot of people in public administration agree that this is a problem, but we don't have a public debate and we don't have a window of opportunity in the most parliaments. So we were discussing this, but then we thought, when we don't have a public debate, maybe it's our role to initiate this debate. Yeah, and we decided to launch this campaign in September 2017. And then something impressive happens. We started with 31 NGOs, and after the launch of the campaign, we were bombarded with emails and calls, and people said, awesome, this is an awesome campaign. Can we join? And right now we have 161 initiatives from all over the world that signed this open letter that said we want to be part of this coalition, because in the long run maybe there will be somehow, somewhere a window of opportunity, and then when we can work together with this open letter, with this community, to make a change. And we have a lot of big names on this list, such as, for example, the Tor Project or Mozilla as well. And we got also very surprising support. Maybe you remember in September 2017, there was a huge public debate about how to secure public IT infrastructure against attacks. And because back then there was this debate about the WannaCry incident, we had the situation that a lot of institutions, even public infrastructure, had to deal with this huge global attack. And we had also this the debate, how could a secure infrastructure look like for the critical infrastructure. And some of our communities said, maybe use more free software could be a solution. So Edward Snowden said, yeah, sign this campaign to all his followers, which was very cool for this campaign. And he sent us a quote, which says, quote, "Right now, the blueprints for much of our most critical public infrastructure are simply unavailable to the public. By aligning public funding with a free software requirement, free referring to public code availability, not costs, we can find and fix flaws before they are used to turn the lights out in the next hospital." And the last sentence of this quote refers to the situation in Great Britain after WannaCry. Yeah, there were hospitals which could not operate because their infrastructure failed. Yeah, and so this quote makes clear that this is not only about transparency, costs, and so on. This is also about how to secure public infrastructure against attacks, and also, of course, backdoors maybe from other secret services or others. But we did not only had a lot of support from NGOs, initiatives from all over the world, but I'm happy to announce that I guess this week we reached 20,000 signatures for our open letter, and I'm very happy about this because it's very interesting to read or to scroll through the comments and to see why people signed this open letter. Yeah, you can leave a comment there, and I just looked through the comments, and actually there are very interesting points which were also reasons why we launched this campaign in the first place. For example, one comment from Germany says that open source leads to more security and more innovation. Both are desperately needed in the public space. Yeah, and this argument of more or better innovation processes through free software is really something that we experience, this argument is heard a lot when we talk to people from public administration, because imagine the situation, you have city A and they maybe have a cool app, and there's city B and they say, yeah, cool app, we want to use it as well, and maybe we want to enhance it with a new feature, and we would be totally happy to share it. But if this app is not under a free license, then it's really difficult to go through all these formal processes of doing so. And another user from Sweden commented, quote, "This is how we get transparency, good quality, and healthy IT investments." Yeah, and this transparency argument is very important as well, because some time ago, I think also a year ago, we had in Germany this incident with the software PCWahl. It was an election helping tool for administrations to count together the votes of a region or of a specific region in Germany, and the CCC found that the software has very severe security problems, and also the software was, of course, not open source. This was a black box kind of, and so this example shows that it's also very, very important for public institutions and their critical infrastructure for democracy to have a certain transparency that we can prove that the software actually does what it should and not something completely else, especially when it comes to election or other things. And another comment came from Norway, from a user from Norway, and he wrote that, "I think taxpayer money the government spends on developing software should be open sourced so the taxpayers can benefit from it." And this is an argument we hear a lot when we talk to people from civil society who says, yeah, maybe sometimes there is a nice, cool software, a nice app we can maybe use in other contexts. And maybe also here, the innovation aspect. If we have a nice enhancement, so why can't we just use the app, enhance it, and share it then again with public institutions? Yeah, and another comment which really made my day when I read it, or I discovered it in the list of comments, says, "We need to go to space with a useful software. An astronaut must be able to fix his or her own software at Starship. Think about it." Yeah. And the interesting fact is that actually the NASA and the ESA, the European Space Program, they use a lot free software, and they publish everything they develop for themselves in the open. So they really believe that there is no security problem with free software. The contrary is true, because they say when we publish it in the open, then we have checks and balances. We can discover security flaws faster, we can fix it. And we also benefit from this large community. And I think today, if you want to launch like a space program to Mars or to the moon or whatever, you can't do it without Linux. It's completely impossible. But we were also extremely happy about the growing support from public administrations. Actually, we have also some institutions, some government institutions, or some local regions that said we support this open letter. They even signed it, such as, for example, the Samtgemeinde Elbmarsch from Germany or the city of Barcelona. And they even publicly announced that this is our official policy. We want others to follow this example, because we are actually doing this already in our region. So in the last months, we were a lot. We communicated this campaign a lot on conferences, and we got a lot of very positive feedback from people, especially from politics and the public administration. And they say, we really like this idea, we want to push it, maybe someday we can also sign this open letter, but we need help. We need help from you. We need, for example, advice. What are the lessons learned from existing cool free software projects in the public administrations, and how can we use this as arguments? Or what are example good arguments I can present to my local representative? Easy to understand arguments for maybe people who are even not in the IT or not expert on this topic. And do you have maybe also something printed out on paper I can hand them over? And another comment request we got quite often was, what are, from your point of view, the best practices in Europe or worldwide we can show to decision makers? For instance, it's much easier to argue that, please change your policy, or please try it at least in this one project, because there are plenty of other cities who are already doing this, and it works. It is a trend, it is a success story. And because if you don't present these best practices or these use cases, then people might think, okay, it's science fiction and you think it should work, but in reality, maybe it's not. So there are a lot of cool use cases, and it's important also to name them. So some months ago, we decided at the Free Software Foundation to take all these questions and comments that followed the launch of the campaign and make a publication out of it, a publication that answers all these questions. And this publication was released last month. It's called Public Money, Public Code, Modernizing Public Infrastructure with Free Software. And it's specifically made for decision makers in politics and public administrations which maybe haven't even heard of free software, or think, oh, free software, it's like freeware. No, it's not. And so really to explain a lot, and to show that it actually works, and this concept is already a success story. And of course, this publication was published under Creative Commons license, and you can download it or order it at fsfe.org. So what's the content of a brochure? We decided that, of course, we could write all the texts by ourselves, but why should we do this when there are so many experts from many different fields, such as from science, or maybe also from public administrations or other institutions that can share their experience with the existing free software projects in public administration. And for instance, we had an interview in this brochure with Francesca Breyer. Francesca Breyer is the CTIO of the city of Barcelona. And she said also something very interesting in this interview. She said that now we have 3,000 companies that work with us. Over 60% are small and medium-sized companies. And of course, most of these companies come from the region of Barcelona. And this is a very important argument for some politicians or some parties, that you also kind of support your local IT community or local companies instead of maybe large corporations, which in the end, yeah, want to lock you in their business model. And another best practice we present in our brochure, there are actually two texts about this, comes from Switzerland, from Bern. In Bern, there was this interesting case in 2011. The Swiss federal court decided that they want to manage a court management system called Open Justitia. And a lot of people liked it a lot, this idea of going open, but there was this small company from Bern, which was called Web Law, and they said, yeah, we don't like this idea, because we argue that publishing software is, in this way, by a government institution, distorts the market, yeah? You could argue maybe they wanted to sell their product and now see, like, this is a problem for our business model, but, yeah. In the end, unfortunately, this argument of a small company triggered a debate in Switzerland. And some politicians from some party actually believed in this and were not sure, yeah, can we still publish free software as government institution? Should we do this? Should we not do this? How is the legal situation? Unfortunately, in Switzerland, we have a very nice group of parliamentarians, which is called PALDIGI. It consists of around about 50 members of different parties from different parliaments in different regions in Switzerland, and they work on digital sustainability. Yeah, and they said, okay, we need to enter in this debate and present some arguments, some facts why we still should go open, and we not only should maybe not take these arguments of a small company serious, but in fact we should go more open. Yeah, and they asked Professor Dr. Simon Schlauri to do a legal study, like what's the legal situation? Can we publish free software without distorting the market? And he found in this research something very interesting. Not only he said, this is not a problem, but he said, quote, an exclusive focus on closed source software could violate the principle of competition neutrality. And this is a very powerful statement, because when you do the statement, you say, yeah, okay, you're distorting the market if you say, yeah, free software, we don't want any free software here, because yeah, a fair competition includes all the participants, even the ones who say, yeah, we have maybe a better business model for you, where you don't get locked in. So this example is very a powerful example, because it shows that it's worth fighting for better legislation, yeah? And in the end, it could happen that we win. Yeah, and right now we have a situation that the city of Bern, which is the second largest region in Switzerland, publishes a lot of free software actually. The newest project from last year was software to manage childcare funds. Yeah, and there are a lot of more free software projects in the pipeline. So we are very hopeful that the future is brighter than the past. And yeah, next. Basanta Tapa will present some of his findings. He also wrote a contribution for this brochure.
Yes, thank you, Katha, for introducing the campaign and the publication. And I'll now focus on the issue of public procurement of free software, so government buying or ordering free software, which is actually what my contribution is about, because you would expect there to be much more use of free software in government, because many European countries actually have some kind of strategy papers or guidelines in place fostering or asking for more use of public of free software in government, but it's not happening. And I'll try to explain this to you by looking at the perspective of government and then the perspective of free software companies. So in my opinion, there are four main factors that lead to government not buying or using free software. And the first and most basic one are procurement requirements. So if you're a government institution and you're trying to procure something, you're trying to buy something, there are certain requirements that are meant to keep a level playing field. Everyone gets the same chance. And there are some rules, for example, there are minimum requirements for the size of a company or for the age of a company, which are actually meant as safeguards against companies going bust. Imagine your government office, you've just bought a new software, and the next month the company actually producing the software goes bankrupt. What do you do? Now you have a software, no one's there to maintain it. It's a bad situation. This regulation is meant to prohibit this, but of course it doesn't make much sense with free software, and it actually keeps free software from being adopted because, as we heard from Francesca Bria as well, most of the free software companies in Europe are actually small and medium enterprises. So this is something that's not exclusive to free software, but it's just a side effect of a regulation that's actually hindering small and medium enterprises from bidding in public tenders. And there's also the procurement procedures are sometimes quite tedious. Sometimes in some countries you have to fill out long questionnaires on what's your company, what's your product, blah, blah, blah. Sometimes you need certain certificates, for example, on labor standards and where is your material sourced and all this kind of stuff. And if you're a small and medium enterprise, it can be quite a hassle to actually fill out these questionnaires, get those certificates, especially if you're, you know, there's no guarantee that you will actually win the contract and you will be compensated for your investment in going through all of these procedures. So that's number one, keeping government from actually buying free software. Then there's a very, very important factor. That's the lack of understanding for free software in government. So some people in government, of course, understand free software. Many don't. I've personally had you know, situations where people in public procurement offices, obviously they're mistaking freeware and free software. I've had had a nice comment where someone said to me, so you expect us to use software that some kid in Finland is programming to fulfill our legal obligations towards citizens? You know, so that would be totally irresponsible of us to have amateur software in such a sensitive area. So just, you know, to get into the mindset, if you see it from this perspective, of course it's totally irresponsible because they don't understand that they could actually pay a professional company to you know, produce this free software and not necessarily some kid in Finland who might also be very talented and very good at what he does. And also there's the classical issue of IT security. So the argument of course goes, how can open source be safe or secure? If you are able to look at the code, you can find all the weak spots, you can find all the backdoors. So by nature, if it's open source, it's less secure, which is of course, government always wants to go the secure way. So there needs to be more understanding education in government before we see more adoption. Then there's also the issue of procurement goals. Of course, government, there are lots of goals behind public procurement, but to keep it simple, the number one goal in public procurement is legal compliance. So when government is buying something, their main concern is to buy it in a way that's legal and no one will sue them after that, as the Swiss company, the Weblaw company did. So that's the number one concern. And everything else is secondary. So if you have Europe, if you have some kind of national strategy paper saying, well, it would be nice if you also bought more free software, you'll be like, yeah, that's, you know, we'll get to that later. First of all, let's try to do it legally compliant. And a second aspect is that public procurement offices are usually service providers for other government offices. So their main concern is if some government office says, well, could you get us this software, they will just, you know, try to get them that software if it's available on the market and they can do it in a legally compliant way. Instead of going other ways, there are of course procurement instruments such as functional tenders where you're basically saying, I, the government, have a specific problem and I will buy any solution, reasonably priced solution that solves this problem. which is a good way for free software to get into this market, instead of, you know, the procurement office saying that we need this product, it has to have these specifications and use these file formats, and then you're basically already saying I'm trying to buy Microsoft Office here. And then there's the strategic perspective, which is also an issue. It's actually, well, government has a long established tradition of using proprietary software. They're used to this, they know how it works. And they shy away from the switching costs of, you know, going away from SAP or whoever. Which also applies if you switch to a free software solution, it's probably, involving switching costs. And I guess, you know, this is a very wholesale statement, but if you take a long run perspective, so you're not just looking at the switching costs, which might be very high in the first year, but if you look at it in the long run, and especially if you adopt free software across government, it's probably the same price or even cheaper to switch to free software. But then you need to have this kind of long-term perspective, which is an issue in public procurement. And of course, I said, you know, if you switch across government, this is also a problem. In Germany, we've had a few cases where a local government that were actually using Open Office, for example, after a few years switched back to Microsoft Office because they said, well, our colleagues in other cities, they can't open our files. You know, this, where's the interoperability here? We're going back to the established solution. So you need a lot of coordination to actually, you know, have everyone in government switch to avoid these kinds of interoperability issues. Yes, so let's switch to the free software companies' perspective. What can free software companies do, maybe, to alleviate these kinds of troubles? Well, of course, they can become big and old to fulfill the procurement requirements. And this, of course, can also mean, you know, merge or maybe form alliances. For example, in France, there's a number of larger free software companies that then also have better access to government. It can also mean, you know, having more endurance for these tedious procurement processes. Someone has to take the grenade. If no free software companies bids on these public procurements processes or tenders, on these public tenders, then there's no surprise that government doesn't buy the free software. Yes, another issue, of course, lobbying. So there are, in many European countries, there are actually procurement regulations that make it hard for free software to access, because these rules were written in times where it's basically everything was proprietary software, or basically what government used was all proprietary software. So there needs to be some kind of organized voice saying, you know, you need to change those laws. You're actually distorting competition. It can also mean writing guidelines for how governments can actually procure free software in a legally compliant way in the existing regulations, which is something that has happened in a few countries, and public administration were quite thankful, because they're always looking for the safe way, and if you're giving them one, it makes it easier for them. But you need some kind of business association to do this. And as a final point, a bit of a provocation, there's also the issue of a certain degree of arrogance in the free software community, whose stance is basically, I'm back, okay. So, sabotage. History will prove us right. You know, we know our IT. You government guys, you're old fashions, you don't know your IT. Ha ha, look at you, you don't even know what free software is. I think that's a problem, because actually there's quite a lot of common ground between government and the free software community. They have similar goals. Government also wants to avoid lock-in situations, because they're costly, and they're also very much interested in sovereignty, and also digital sovereignty. They don't want to be dependent on private companies telling them what they can or can't do. So what we need is, because we see here's arrogance, there's lack of understanding. We need more communication and between these two communities, and I think this publication is a good first step, and we need more of that, and I can just ask all of you guys to recommend this publication to your local government so they can also see the light. Thank you.
Very much. Are there any questions? Yeah, there's one.
As you say free software, I must ask you what kind of free software you mean. Because just to compare GPL and AGPL, as we are today in service, everything end up in end with a service, I could distribute things in GPL that would use by Google close server and given to people with a service of search without people knowing what that search is. I just close the cycle of AGPL will allow to know the code of the search when you would want it, as you should have it when you have it in GPL. My point here that it's like if we talk about the public, we must understand that mostly there is the business of service, and therefore the free software should be service-oriented free software, and that is AGPL, not GPL. So what do you think about it?
Yeah, this is a very specific question, and I don't know if I understood you right. You were talking also about Google. Yeah, so the Free Software Foundation uses the definition of free software, which also the Free Software Foundation Europe and the FSF share the same definition, which says that free software under our understanding of free software is software with four freedoms and not more restrictive licenses. So we have an official list of what kind of licenses we see as free. As in our definition, and but I really think that of course we could debate about what is the best free software license. This would be another talk of maybe 8 hours, and but still I think this brochure explicitly says there is this list what we regard as good licenses, but we still think that the first step is that they at least consider free licenses at all. This is the main problem. After that you can argue like what is the best free license for your purpose. And we highly recommend also public administrations to use established licensing models and not like to reinvent a new one, which is also like a common problem, because this way it's difficult for others to see what does this new license mean.
The mic doesn't work anymore, so here's another question.
One question about the publication. Is the publication only available in English, or you have translations in the different countries of the remaining members of the European Union?
Yeah, this is as an NGO, this is also always a matter of funding. We first decided that we want to get this out in English so that maybe others are able to translate it. And we are right now discussing to make translations in two or maybe three other languages. But it's not decided yet. And also we need to see how much funding we have to do it. But we are definitely considering it, especially because reading a long brochure in English is is a hurdle or is difficult for some institutions.
And there's another question.
Have you considered pushing for the open source software in context of the security debate about Huawei and others, where the public bodies think about bending the procurement rules to exclude certain vendors or to have a strategic approach to procurement which would allow to choose other software vendors or to have rules that force open source or the publication of code for certain hardware?
Yeah, of course, this is, the IT security aspect is very, I think, a very important point, especially when you talk about critical infrastructure, and we also have like one text in this brochure specifically about this, which also argues like, no, free software is not insecure because, hey, look at all these large companies which would not exist without free software. Yeah? And when there was this huge debate about PC-Wahl in Germany, also the CCC actively pushed this campaign. They said like, okay, here's the problem, this is the solution. You should, as you said, act more strategically, like what are our interests? Okay, our interests are maybe privacy, autonomy, and so on, yeah, and not having backdoors in our software. So this is the way you need to go, yeah. And I think also this, we need more partners to lobby for this, yeah. And I also think this is a very powerful argument, especially when you talk to conservative parties, which think like, oh, okay, free software, this is maybe about community and sharing and. We're not sure if this is a Finnish hacker or kids who is programming this, but the security aspect is really something like people start listening to you.
Okay. Are there any other questions? Okay, then thank you a lot.
Yeah, and if you want, there are some of the brochures and also some books from the FIT you can take if you want.